بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسوله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد apologies إخوة for the lateness inshallah we begin the fifth sitting now the fourth sitting one second let me just get that بسم الله So let me just get that. طيب بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسوله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد So today بإذن الله carry on with the fourth sitting here في حكم قيام رمضان So it's going to be about standing in the month of Ramadan for the night prayer which is Taraweeh قيام الليل So بسم الله begin So here Begin with الحمد لله الذي أعان بفضله الأقدام السالكة وأنكذ برحمته النفوس الحالكة ويسر من شاء ليسر فرغب في الآخرة أحمده على الأمور اللذيذة والشائكة وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ذو العزة والقهر فكل نفوس له ذليلة آنية وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله القائم بأمر ربه سرا وعلانية صلى الله عليه وعلى صاحبه أبي بكر الذي تحرد عليه الفرقة الآفكة وعلى عمر الذي كانت نفسه لنفسه مالكة وعلى عثمان منفق الأموال المتكاثرة وعلى منفرق الأبطال في الجموع المتكاثفة وعلى بقية الصحابة والتابعين لهم بإحسان ما قرعت الأقدام أسالك وسلم تسليما So here, after the introduction, the lengthy introduction from the Sheikh, we begin bismillah, saying all praise belongs to Allah, the one who, with his mercy and who aids those people with their feet, he by way of his bounty. He assists the feet of those who tread the path of on the path of Allah, and he saves the perishing the souls from being perished, and he makes easy the path of guidance for one who seeks the hereafter, and I praise Allah upon. The affairs that are in the affairs of a person's life that are sweet and bitter, and I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped except in Allah alone, and that He has no partner with Him. He is the possessor of so He is by Him and without a partner, and He's the owner of might and power. All souls humble to Him willingly or unwillingly. And all souls depend on him. Now the Sheikh mentions a bear witness that Muhammad is his slave and messenger, the one who executed the command of his Lord secretly and openly. Yeah. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him and upon his companions Abu Bakr, upon his companion Abu Bakr, and who is attacked by the falsifying sect. Here the Sheikh means the Rafida, the Shia, who attack Abu Bakr and their likes. And upon Umar, the one who was able to control his soul. And upon Uthman, the one who spent abundant wealth in the way of Allah. And upon Ali, the one who drove the enemies away in a severe clash of abundant hosts. So when he fought against the Khawarij. Upon the rest of his companions and those who follow their footsteps in a proper manner till the day of judgment. So then inshallah we begin with this sitting. So the Sheikh, he mentions here, Bismillah, he says, Ikhwani, he says, my brothers, so let's get that. So he says, Ikhwani, لقد شرع الله لعباده الإبادات ونوعها لهم ليأخذوا من كل نوع منها بنصيب ولئلا لا يمل من النوع الواحد فيترك العمل فيشقى الواحد فيشقى الواحد واحد منهم ويخيب. So here the Sheikh is saying, oh, my dear brothers, indeed Allah has legislated for his servants different types of worship for them, so that they can take from each type of worship a share, a portion. And that is so that they do not become bored from one particular type of worship, so therefore they end up leaving that action and they become from the wretched ones. And from the ones who lose. And Allah has made, then his Sheikh said, وَجَعَلَ مِنْحَا فَرَائِدٍ فَرَائِدٍ لَا يَجُوزُ النَّقْسُ فِيهَا وَلَا الْإِخْلَالِ وَمِنْهَا النَّوَافِلُ يَحْصُلُ بِهَا زِيَادَةُ التَّقَرُّبِ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالْإِكْمَالِ. So the Sheikh, he mentions here that Allah made from these that are actions, the worship that is wajib, obligatory, that is norm, that is not permissible to have any deficiency in it, you know, and also he made from it supererogatory actions, sunnah, yeah, and nafil, nawafil, so that a person can attain with that and increase in closeness and nearness to Allah and to complete his the obligatory forms of worship. As we know, in the Day of Judgment, you can be asked upon the wajib and then, you know, the sunnah and the nawafil that you came with. So then the Sheikh goes on, he said, mentions, فَمِنْ ذَلِكَ الصَّلَاةُ فَرَضَ اللَّهُ مِنْهَا عَلَىٰ إِبَادِهِ خَمْسَ صَلَوَاتٍ فِي الْيَوْمِ وَالْلَّيْلَةِ خَمْسًا فِي الْفِعْلِ وَخَمْسِينَ فِي الْمِيزَانِ. So the Sheikh, he says, and from those, you know, actions is there's a worship from those acts of worship is the salah, the prayer that Allah made obligatory upon the servants, five daily prayers that a person performs in the day and the night, and there are five in the person carrying out actions, but they're 50 in reward. So there are five prayers, but they're rewarded with 50 on the scales. وَنَذَبَ اللَّهُ إِلَىٰ زِيَادَةِ التَّطَوَّئِ مِنَ الصَّلَوَاتِ تَقْمِيلًا لِحَاذِهِ الْفَرَائِدِ. And then Allah mentions that Allah, appointed these nawafil, these optional forms of worship, the rawatib, that are a completion for any deficiency that you have in your prayer, for example. So وَزِيَادَةَ فِي قُرْبَ إِلَيْهِ فَمِنْ هَذَا من هذه النوافل الرواتب التابعة للصلوات المفروضة. So he said these are the Sheikh mentions that these are so that a person can get close to Allah by way of these optional nawafil and these rawatib prayers that follow on from the obligatory prayers. So these, as we mentioned, they can come before the prayer, as the Sheikh mentioned now, or come after the fard prayer. So here, rak'atan qabla salat al-fajr. So there's two rak'ah, the two rak'ah sunnah before the salat al-fajr. And the Prophet mentioned that, you know, better than what is in the world, The two salah of Fajr, two rakat of Fajr, the Sunnah, better than the world and what is in it. And the wa arba rakaatin qabla dhuhr wa rakaatan ba'daha, and there's four rakat sunnah that are before the fard of salat al-dhuhr and two rakat after. And then he mentioned wa rakaatani ba'd al-maghrib, and there's two rakats of the sunnah of the rawatib after the fard of maghrib, and wa rakaatani ba'd al-isha'i, and two rakat after isha. So these are the sunnahs that are in the day for the five daily prayers that accompany the five daily prayers. وَمِنْهَا صَلَاتُ اللَّيْلِ الَّتِي امْتَدَهَا اللَّهُ فِي كِتَابِهِ الْقَائِمِينَ بِهَا فَقَالَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا. That's Surah Furqan. Allah mentions also, وَقَالَ تَتَجَافَ جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَدَاجِئِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفٌ وَتَمَعًا وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ جَزَاءٌ بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. So here we're just going to translate that. So then the Sheikh, he goes on to say that the meaning of and from these rawati, the optional prayers, is the prayer, the night prayer, which Allah praises the one who established the night prayer in the Book of Allah, in the Quran. So when he said the Most High, so Allah the Most High, when he says, وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا وَقِيَامًا. So, and those who spend the night in worship of their Lord, they basically prostrate and standing. So they prostrate and standing. They spend the night, and this is what we call tahajjud. Yeah, the Salatul Tahajjud. So here now, then the Shaykh mentions the Surah Furqan, verse 46. And then Allah mentions in the next ayah, تَتَجَافَ جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَضَاجِئِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفٌ وَتَمَعٌ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. They sighs forsake their beds to invoke the Lord in fear and hope, and they spend in charity in Allah's cause out of what we have bestowed upon them. And then the ayah continues, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةٍ أَعْيُنٍ جَزَاءً بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. So no person knows what is kept hidden for them of joy as a reward for what they used to do. So this is attached to the person who performs the night prayer, the tahajjud. So here these are the benefits the Shaykh mentions. وَقَالَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أفضل الصلاة بعد الفريدة صلاة الليل رواه مسلم. So then the Sheikh says that that's from the Quran before, now from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from his hadith, he said the best of prayers after the obligatory prayers are the night prayer. So the tahajjud, as we know the benefits of that in other hadith as well, that Allah descends to the lowest heaven and he asks, who will be. The rough meaning of the hadith is that, who seeks forgiveness so that it be forgiven, and who seeks so that Allah will give them. Yeah. So in that, obviously, in that hadith, if we've gone through it, it's an affirmation of Allah descending. Yeah. So we affirm that Allah is above his throne. He rises and above, descends his throne, the way that befits his majesty, and we do not ask how. So then, also the Sheikh mentions another hadith, so that was from Sahih Muslim, from the two books, Bukhari Muslim, that are the most authentic after the Quran. So then the Sheikh mentions, the Prophet said, أيها الناس أفشوا السلام وأطعموا الطعام وصلوا الأرحام وصلوا بالليل والناس نيام تدخل الجنة بالسلام. So here in the, and that's رواه الترمذي وقال حسن صحيح وصححه الحاكم. So here in this another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, "O people, yeah, spread the salam, yeah, the greeting of peace, yeah, salamu alaykum, yeah, spread that salam, wa and feed the poor, the masakin, the poor people, yeah, feed them, and keep the ties of kinship, yeah, the ties of kinship meaning, you know, your family, you know, your mother, your father." You know, respecting them, your brothers, your sisters, your aunts, your uncles. You know, keep them ties or blood relationship. Keep them ties, yeah. And don't forsake them. Don't fall out. You know, this is a time of this month as well. It's time to rectify that. If you do have any, you know, grievances, to rectify that and let bygones be bygones. Our goal is the Jannah. Our goal is not this dunya. So we don't see, oh, we're going to look like a weak person if we try to. You know, try to resolve things. No, we resolve things and we do it for the sake of Allah. The reward is with Allah. And then he said, and wasallu bilayl, and pray the night prayer while the people are sleeping, and enter the Jannah with peace. So look at that, mashallah, look at that greatness. This is narrated by Tirmidhi, and it's mentioned that it's Sahih, Hasan Sahih, and is also Al Hakim, also graded Sahih. So it's Sahih Hadith, and look at the benefits in that. Look how many benefits we had. Spreading the salam, while another hadith Prophet said, you know, spread the salam with those you know and those who you don't know. And this will increase the love of the people for you, inshallah. And this is something that a lot of people don't do. And you need to give those salam to the Muslims that you know and that you don't know. And then after every fard salah, so then he said that, feed the poor people. Alhamdulillah, we need to do that more in this month than in any other month. So we're going through the experience of, you know, what hunger feels like. We're doing that for the sake of Allah, but we need to help our Muslim brothers, whether they be in Afghanistan, where a lot of people have forsaken them, especially in this time where people are not even recognizing, you know, whoever's ruling. We have no connection with that. But we need to make, aid our Muslim brothers and sisters who are going poor, where these shayateen, you know, taking, looting their wealth, £7 billion by the American government, you know, they've taken that. You know, no one's batted an eye in regards to that. But yeah, it's all about Ukraine day and night, you know. So, and look at Syria as well, yeah. And so, yeah, whatever you can do to aid the Muslims. And even in this country, you know, if you know any poor people, any of your neighbors, feed them. This is a month that we've got to be generous. And you keep your ties of kinship, as we mentioned, and also praying the night prayer. And with that, enter Jannah with peace. MashaAllah, great hadith. So we need to take advantage of these narrations and, you know, apply them and not just be a lip service that we read and we heard them. No, inshallah, Allah give us the tawfiq to apply them in our life. Then the Sheikh, he goes on, he says, وَمِنَ السَّلَاةِ اللَّيْلِ الْوِتْرُ أَقَلُّهُ رَكَعَةٌ وَأَكْثَرُهُ إِحْدَى عَشَرَ رَكَعَةٌ. So then he said, the Sheikh mentioned, and from the night prayer is the witr. Yeah, and the witr being odd, yeah, meaning in the meaning of the witr is what? So it's from the night prayer that you, the least of its number being one rak'ah. And the highest number being 11 rak'ah. So for you tiru bi rak'atin mufarrida li qawli Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man ahabba an yu'tir bi wahidatin falyaf'al. So then the Sheikh mentions that doing witr with one rak'ah is also reported from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said, whoever likes to perform witr with one rak'ah, let him do that. Yeah, and that's narrated by Abu Dawood and Nisa'i. So that was for with one, the proof for one witr, for one rak'ah. Wa yu'tiru bi thalath li qawli Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man ahabba an yu'tira bi thalathin falyaf'al. So then the proof for the three rak'ah So remember, it's odd, it can't be even. So it won't be two. It'll be going on from one and go to three. And then the Prophet said, whoever wants to, likes to perform witr with three rakah, let him do that. And that's also reported by Abu Dawud wa Nisa'i. So that's proof of both one rakah and three rakah. فَإِنْ أَحَبَّ صَرَدَحَا بِسَلَامٍ وَاحِدٍ لَمْ لِمَا رَوَأَ التَّحَاوِي عَنْ عُمَرِ بْنِ خَطَّابِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَوْتَرَ بِالثَّلَاثِ رَقَعَةٍ لَمْ يُسَلِّمْ إِلَّا فِي آخِرِهِنَّ وَإِنْ أَحَبَّ سَلَّى رَقَعَتَيْنِ وَسَلَّمَ ثُمَّ سَلَّى ثَلَاثَةً لِمَا رَوَأَ الْبُخَارِي عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما أنه كان يسلم بين ركعتين وركعتي في الوتر حتى كان يأمر ببعض حاجته يأمر ببعض حاجته ويؤطر بخمس فيسردها جميعا لا يجلس ولا يسلم illa fi akhirihinna. So here the Sheikh, he mentions that if a person wants to pray these consistent, you know, one after another, subsequently with one salam, they're like praying all three rakat. So not having a sitting, sitting only at the last rakat, having a sitting. So remember, the witr is not the same as Maghrib. In the Maghrib Salah, you pray the first rakah, you sit in the second rakah, get up and read the third rakah. The witr is odd, so it is three rakah, but it's got to be different from the Maghrib. So here, you can either, as the Sheikh mentioned, that you can read the first rakah, the second rakah, don't sit down, get back up, and then complete the third rakah, and then sit for the final rakah. So that's what you can do, as mentioned by Imam At-Tahawi. Who is Imam At-Tahawi? He's the famous Imam who has a book of Aqidat al-Tahawiyyah. He was Hanafi. And, you know, mashallah, it's a great book that many of the scholars have explained for the Aqidah of Ahl Sunnah, the Salaf. Yeah? That is mentioned that from Tahawi, that is gone back to Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, from the companion Umar radiallahu anhu, from the Khalifa, that he used to pray with three rakah, and he didn't used to perform taslim except in the last rakah. So that is paying three consecutive rakahs and sitting down for the last one and giving salam. And then if you like, you can pray two rakah. So that is one way of reading three rakah. There's another way of reading three rakah, and that is to pray rakah, sit down on the second rakah, give salam, yeah, finish that, and then get up and read that one rakah by itself, and when you sit down, give salam outside. So you got two taslim and then one by itself, sitting down and then taslim. So that's two ways of performing that, and that was mentioned by Imam Bukhari. And on the sunnah, on the authority of Abdullah bin Umar, may Allah be pleased with both of them, and that he used to give salam between the two rakah. After the two rakah, then you know, if he had any need to drink or eat or whatever that need might have been, then he would come back and read that, finish with that one rakah. So that was the one rakah, and then we described how to read or pray the three rakah witr, one by consecutively praying and sitting in the final rakah, and then one by praying two rakah, giving taslim, giving salam on both sides, and then getting up and reading the one rakah by itself. Then the Sheikh got carried on and said, "Wa yutir bi khams fa yasruduha jami'an." لا يجلس ولا يسلم إلا في آخرهن لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من أحب أن يؤتر بخمس فليفعل رواه أبو داود ونسائي وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي من الليل 13 ركعة يؤثر من ذلك بخمس لا يجلس في شيء منهن إلا في آخرهن، متفق عليه. ويؤثر بسبع فيصردها كالخمس، لقول أم سلمة رضي الله عنها كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يؤثر بسبع وبخمس لا يفصل بينهن بسلام ولا كلام، رواه أحمد والنسائي وابن ماجه. So here the Sheikh mentions that we mentioned the first one rakah, we mentioned the three rakah, the two ways of reading the three rakah. Now he said that you can also, the Prophet ﷺ used to pray witr with five rakah. And how he would pray the five rakah? He would do that by praying all five rakahs without having a sitting in there. So he wouldn't sit except for the last rakah, where he would sit on the fifth rakah and give salam. And that, so that is a proof from the hadith that the Prophet ﷺ would love to pray with five rakah. Whoever loves to or likes to pray with five rakah witr, then he can let him do so. And that was narrated by Abu Dawood and Nisa'i. And Aisha radiallahu anha, the mother of the believers, said that the Prophet ﷺ used to pray the night prayer as 13 rakah. So that's 13 rakah. He wouldn't go more than that. Yeah? So he would pray 13 rakah, and he used to make witr with 5 rakah. And he didn't used to sit in any one of the rakah except for the last one. So that means that you're standing, you know, for the first 4. And when you sit on the 4th rakah, when you finish these 2 sajood, you get back up. You don't stay sitting down. You only sit on the 5th rakah. So that is proved and muttafaqun alayh, meaning Bukhari Muslim, so it's really authentic. So if you anyone want to practice that, they can do that. Even the sunnah, even if you're not used to do it, at least try to do it at least once in your lifetime, so that you know that you can't carry out a sunnah that the Prophet used to carry out. So then he mentioned that also the Prophet, so that was the description of 5. Yeah. So you're only sitting on the last rakah. And then also the Prophet ﷺ would perform witr with 7, where he would consecutively pray the rakah, like the 5th one. And it's mentioned by Salama, one of the believers, that the Prophet ﷺ would perform witr with the 7, like the way of 5, that he didn't used to sit down and give salam. No, he would complete all 7 and then sit on the 7th rakah and then give the salam. So his sitting would be with the 7th rakah. And that was mentioned by Imam Ahmed and Nisa'i and Ibn Majah. Then the Sheikh goes on and he says, وَيُوتِرُ بِتِسْءٍ فَيَسْرُدُهَا لَا يَجْلِسُ إِلَّا فِي الثَّامِنَةِ. And then he's also mentioned that he used to pray with the 9 rakah. So we're all going with the even, where he would not sit down in any of the rakah except for the, except in the 8th rakah. So he would sit down on the 2nd to last rakah, the 8th rakah, and then he would read the tashahud, and he would make the dua, yeah? And then he would stand up, yeah? So he would stand up, and then he wouldn't perform, give a salam. He would stand up, read the 9th rakah, and sit down again, making the dua that you do in the tashahud, and then he would give a salam. So with the 9th rakah, he would perform the sitting on the 8th rakah, get up, and then complete the 9th rakah, and then sit down for the 9th rakah and give salam. And that is for the, and the proof of that is the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha. And في وتر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قالت كان يصلي 9 ركعات لا يجلس فيها إلا في الثامنة فيذكر الله ويحمده ويدعوه ثم ينحد ولا يسلم ثم يقوم فيصلي 9 ثم يقعد فيذكر الله ويحمده ويدعوه ثم يسلم تسليما تصميم يسمع يسمعنا. So here she mentioned that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, she described how the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would pray the 9 rakah. He wouldn't sit in any of them except for the 8 rakah, where he would mention Allah and praise Him and make du'a. Then he would sit up, and then he would not give salam. Then he would stand up and he would pray the 9th rakah, then sit down and then make the du'a again and praise Allah and make and mention Allah and praise Allah and make du'a. And then he would give make taslim, and that we could hear his taslim. And that's so that's another hadith. Al hadith rawa Ahmad wa Muslim, so is mentioned by Imam Ahmad and Muslim as well, so it's sahih. So then the Shaykh mentions وَيُصَلِّي إِحْدَى عَشَرَ رَكَعَةً, so he prayed also 11 rak'ah. So he went from 9 not to 10, because 10 is even, we went to 11. فَإِنْ أَحَبَّ سَلَّمَ مِنْ كُلِّ رَكَعَتَيْنْ وَأَوْتَرَ بِوَاحِدَةٍ لِحَدِيثِ عَائِشَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا قَالَتْ وَكَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يُصَلِّي مَا بَيْنَ أَنْ يَفْرَغَ من صلاة العشاء إلى الفجر 11 ركعة يسلم بين كل ركعتين ويؤتر بواحدة. الحديث رواه الجماعة إلا الترمذي. So then she mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ would pray 11 ركعة, and she mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ would pray every 2 ركعة he gives salam. So he prayed 2 units of prayer, give salam, then start anew. 2 rak'ah, and he kept doing that up till he did 10, and then he will read the final rak'ah by itself, making it 11. And that is hadith is mentioned by many of the scholars except for Imam al-Tirmidhi. So then he mentioned وَإِنْ أَحَبَّ سَلَّ أَرْبَعًا ثُمَّ ثَالِثًا لِحَدِيثِ عَائِشَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا قَالَتْ كَانَ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يُصَلِّي أَرْبَعًا فَلَا تَسْأَلْ عَنْ خُسْنِهِنَّ وطولهن ثم يصلي 4 فلا تسأل عن حسنهن وطولهن ثم يصلي 3 متفق عليه. So then Aisha radiallahu mentioned that the Prophet would also, he could mention praying in twos and twos and twos, then we said until 10 rakahs are done and then one, but now he mentioned he prayed them in fours. So he prayed 4 and giving salam, then starting another new 4, giving salam, that's 8, then making another 4. So 8, sorry, and then when you don't know 8, then he did 3. Yeah, so he did 8 rak'ah, 4 and 4, and then he read 3. That's how he would read. So she said, don't ask about how long how long, in amazement, she said, how long them 4 rak'ah were. Yeah, they weren't short. And then how beautiful they were and how long they were. Yeah. And then he would do that with 4, 4, and then the last one 3, and muttafaqun alayh. That is for Bukhari and Muslim. So he's mentioned in Bukhari and Muslim. So it's a sahih hadith. So then the Sheikh, he goes on. He mentions wasardul khamsi wa sab'i wa tis'i. إنما يكون إذا صلى وحده أو بجماعة محصورين اختاروا ذلك. So he said, for consecutively, subsequently reading 5 and 7 and 9, this is for people who read by themselves or with a, with a limited number, with a specific number of people, that are known to you, they know that you're going to pray these amount of salahs, yeah? So that's who you pray these with. You either pray by yourself or with a few number of people that know you're going to pray this, yeah? So you chose this, yeah? So they know that you chose this. But أما المساجد العامة فالأولى للإمام أن يسلم في كل ركعتين لأن لا يشق على الناس ويربك ويربك نياتهم ولأن ذلك أيسر لهم وقد قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أيكم أما الناس أيكم أما الناس فليعجز فإن من ورائه الكبيرة والضعيفة وذا الحاجة. وفي لفظ: فإذا صلى وحده فليصلي كيف يشاء. ولأنه لم ينقل أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أوتر بأصحابه بهذه الكيفية، وإنما كان يفعل ذلك في صلاته وحده. So here the Sheikh is mentioning that he said, yeah, as we previously said, that if you're going to do these 5, 7, 9, 11, you know, it's better to do it by yourself when you're praying by yourself, or when you people a certain number of people that you've restricted that know and they've chosen to read this. But as for reading in the general masajid, then you shouldn't do that. It's better for the imam to pray for every two rakat. He should pray two rakat, yeah, every two rakat. So that way he doesn't make it a burdensome, tiresome for the and the people don't doubt in the niyyah, yeah. So they don't doubt in the niyyah of how many rakat they're gonna pray for witr. So because it's easier for them, and the Prophet ﷺ said, if any of you is gonna lead the people, you gotta be mindful of those who are behind him, from the elderly people and from the weak. There might be people who are old age, children, people who've got needs and illnesses, they can't control, hold on to their, bowels for that long. They can't, stand up, for that long. So you need to keep that in mind. And that's mentioned in the hadith. And it's also mentioned in another hadith, if you pray by yourself, then pray however you wish. Yeah. So yeah, take however long you want, but not when you're leading people. You got to be mindful of the people. وَلِإِنَّهُ لَمْ يُنْقَلْ عَنَ النَّبِيِّ. So because it wasn't, hasn't been attributed or narrated from the Prophet ﷺ that he ever prayed in this manner with his companions, praying 5, 7, 9, or 11 in this fashion. But he used to do this by himself, when he was by himself. Then the Shaykh carries on, وَصَلَاتُ اللَّيْلِ فِي رَمَدَانِ لِحَا لَهَا فَضِيلَةٌ وَمُزَيَّ ومزية على غيرها، لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. متفق عليه. So here the Sheikh, he mentions here that the praying the Taraweeh prayer, the Qiyam al-Layl in Ramadan, it has its virtue and its excellence and advantage and superiority other than the prayers, yeah, that are optional, which is according to the Prophet Assam speech, man, whoever establishes the night prayer with iman, with faith, and seeking the reward from Allah, Allah will forgive him what proceeded from him from his sins. And we hope Allah, forgives our sins, and we, Allah enables us to be from those people. Ameen. So it's muttafaqun alayh, meaning that Bukhari Muslim is reported by them. So it's sahih, the highest grade of sahih. And the meaning, wa ma'na qawluhu iman, and this is the Sheikh says, and the meaning of with faith, ay iman billah wa bima a'addahu min al-thawabi lil-qa'imin. So he said that the meaning with faith, it means that believing that having belief, faith in Allah, and the reward that Allah has prepared for the ones who establish this. So they truly believe in that. And وَمَعْنَا قَوْلُهُ اِحْتِسَابًا أي طَلَبًا لِثَوَابِ اللَّهِ لَمْ يَحْمِلْهُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ رِيَاءً ولا سمعة ولا طلب مال ولا جاه. So he said, and the meaning of seeking the reward, meaning that you seek the reward from Allah, and that what is not meant by that is that you do it for the sake of showing off, riya, which is minor shirk, huh? Doing it for so your intention is to show off the people that I can stand up in this much prayer, and I've done this, and you do it out of for your reputation, that he stands up in prayer all night long, or he's beautifies his voice, or whatever else connected with the night prayer, or you try to seek the wealth of the people. They say, oh yeah, let's give money to this guy in his masjid. He beautifies his speech and he makes it long, or try to get a reputation. You don't do it for that. You do it for the sake of Allah. So our niyyah needs to be correct, and we do it for what? For the reward with Allah. Yeah. وقيام رمضان شامل للصلاة في أول الليل وآخره. So yeah, it's وآخره وعلى هذا فالتراويح من قيام رمضان. So he said, the Sheikh mentions, and standing in Ramadan is included in the Salah, in the, whether it's in the beginning of the night or at the end of the night. So upon this, the Taraweeh is from the standing of Ramadan. So that we mentioned all the benefits of and the virtues of standing and the Tashahud. So the same benefits apply for the Taraweeh. So it's the same prayer. So فَيَنْبَغِي الْحِرْسُ عَلَيْهِ وَالْإِعْتِنَاهُ بِهَا وَإِحْتِسَابُ الْأَجْرِ وَثَوَابِ مِنَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ. So it's so the people should strive to pray these prayers, and have a concern for them and give them the due, and seeking the reward from Allah for carrying out these prayers. وَمَا هِيَ إِلَّا لَيَالٍ مَعْدُودَةٌ يَنْتَهِزُهَا الْمُؤْمِنُ الْآقِلُ قَبْلَ فَوَاتِهَا. And the Sheikh said, what are they except for a few numbered nights that only the believer, the mu'min, yeah, the believer who is intelligent will take benefit before its lapse and before it's coming being passage, coming to an end. Because Ramadan comes, as you say, oh, we want to wait for Ramadan. It comes and it goes so quickly. Time passes so quickly. So we need to make sure that we benefit and we've taken our share of reward from this blessed month. وَإِنَّمَا سُمِيَتْ تَرَاوِيهَا لِأَنَّ النَّاسَ كَانُوا يُطِيلُونَهَا جِدًّا فَكُلَّمَا سَلُّ أَرْبَعَ رَكْعَاتٍ إِسْتَرَاهُ قَلِيلًا. And the Sheikh, he mentions that the actual name Taraweeh is actually derived from the fact that the people, when it was originally prayed, they used to pray really lengthy prayers, and they used to, and every time they pray, after they prayed four rakat, whether they prayed two and two rakat, they would take a rest, for a little bit of time. So, because it was so long that they would be standing, after four rakat were complete, they'd take a rest, and then they would continue again with all the four rakat. And we're going to go into that in more detail. وَكَانَ نَبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَوَّلَ مَنْ سَنَّ الْجَمَاعَةَ فِي الصَّلَاةِ تَرَاوِيهِ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ ثُمَّ تَرَكَهَا خَوْفًا مِنْ أَنْ ترفض على أمته. وفي صحيح عن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى في المسجد ذات ليلة وصلى بصلاته ناس ثم صلى من القابلة وكثر الناس ثم اجتمعوا من ليلة الثالثة أو الرابعة فلم يخرج إليهم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فلما أصبح قال قد رأيت الذي صنعتم فلم يمنعني من الخروج إليكم إلا إني خشيت أن تفرض عليكم قال وذلك في رمضان وأنا أبي ذر رضي الله عنه قال صمنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فلم يقم بنا حتى بقي سبع من الشهر فقام بنا حتى ذهب ثلث الليل ثم لم يقم بنا في السادسة ثم قام بنا في الخامسة حتى ذهب شطر الليل أي نصفه فقلنا يا رسول الله لو نفلتنا بقي ليلتنا هذه. فقال إنه وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن من قام مع الإمام حتى ينصرف كتب له قيام الليلة. الحديث رواه أهل السنن بسند صحيح. So here there's a few hadith we're going to mention now. So I just want to just read that chapter, read that paragraph and get to it. So here the person of the Aisha, the Prophet's wife, he mentions that the Prophet was the first one who established the sunnah, yeah, the sunnah of praying in congregation, the Salat al-Taraweeh in the masjid. So he's the first one who established the sunnah. Then he left it fearing that it would become made obligatory upon the nation, upon this ummah, that Allah would make it an obligation. So that's why he left it. So that is why he left it. So then so it's mentioned in the Sahihain, so from Aisha, so in Bukhari and Muslim, so it's a Sahih hadith that Aisha, the mother of the believers, mentioned that the Prophet he would pray a particular night. He prayed a particular night, Ramadan, and the people started to come and they joined him, and then a lot of the people gathered, and then he prayed again on the third night, and then on the fourth night he didn't go out to the people. So then when the daytime came after the fourth night, he said to the people, he saw the people, he said, I saw the people, I saw what you all did. So what prevented me from coming out to you guys, to you all, was nothing except that I feared that it would made this Taraweeh, the prayer, will be made wajib upon you. And that, and then he mentioned that waqala وفي ذلك وذلك في رمضان, and that was in Ramadan. So yeah, so that was in Ramadan, and that is also another hadith that is mentioned that we fasted with the Prophet Sallallahu, and he did not stand in the night with us until the last seven nights of the month. So you can imagine that 23 nights the Prophet Sallallahu didn't come out. Yeah, 20, and then he came out. So he stood and led his prayer till one third of the night was over. So think about that. One third of the night is over. So you're going in close to Fajr. Sorry. So one third of the night, sorry, is, you know, going to midnight now if we were to do it in our time. Then he skipped the sixth night. So he didn't come out on the sixth night. And he prayed with us in the seventh night till half of the night was over. So it's way going past into the morning hours. And he prayed was in the seventh night till half of the night. We said that he prayed with the sixth. He didn't pray with the sixth night. He prayed with the seventh night until half the night was over. So we said to him, "O Messenger of Allah, if you were to pray, you know, the rest of the night, then you know you were to complete the whole night." Unless they thought it would be a benefit. So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Whoever stands with the imam till the imam leaves, it will be written for him the reward of standing the whole night in prayer." And that is graded authentic, you know, by Sheikh Albani and Sheikh Muqbil. Yeah, so it's Sahih. And that shows you that even, you know, so a lot of people, what they do is they tend to pray the Taraweeh prayer. Then they'll do is they'll go home and then they won't pray the Witr, and then they'll go and add on to that. Well, this authentic hadith says that if you pray until the Imam finishes, you pray and finish your prayer, you got prayer. You got the reward of praying all the way to the rest of the night. So yeah. So so then the Sheikh says, وَاخْتَلَفَ السَّلَفُ صَالِحُ فِي عَدَدِ الرَّكَعَاتِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ التَّرَاوِيحِ وَالْوِتْرِ مَعَهَا. فَقِيلَ 41 رَكَعَةً, وَقِيلَ 39, وَقِيلَ 29, وَقِيلَ 23, وَقِيلَ 19, وَقِيلَ 13, وقيل 11, وقيل غير ذلك. وأرجح هذه الأقوال أنها 11 أو 13 لما في صحيحين عن عائشة رضي الله عنها أنها سئلت كيف كانت صلاة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في رمضان، فقالت ما كان يزيد في رمضان ولا غيره على 11 ركعة. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال كانت صلاة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم 13 ركعة يعني من الليل، رواه البخاري. So here the Sheikh is saying that the people, the pious predecessors, the Salaf, they differed upon the exact number of the Taraweeh. So and the witr with it. So it was said that is 41 rakah. So some of the people said it was 41 rakah. Some of them would say that is 39 rakah, and some would say it's 29 rakah, and some said that it was 23 rakah, and some said that it was what 19 rakah, and some said that it was 13 rakah, and some said it was 11 rakah, and other than that. And the most correct is that it was 11 rakah or 13 rakah, you know, if you count in the witr. So it's 11 or 13. And that is mentioned in the Sahihain in Bukhari and Muslim from Aisha radiallahu anha, the mother of the believers, that when she was asked, how did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam pray the night prayer in Ramadan? So she said that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wouldn't increase in Ramadan or other than it, meaning outside of Ramadan, more than 11 rakah. And then from Ibn Abbas, he said, radiallahu anhuma, that he said he wouldn't go more than 13 rakah. So you got 8 rakah, 9, 10, 11. Or if you got more for 3 witr, and then you got more, for example, for your witr, and you make it 13 rakah. So this is mentioned in Bukhari. And it was mentioned in Fiwafil Muwatta and Sa'ib. And Sa'ib ibn Yazid radiallahu anhu qala amara Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu Ubay ibn Ka'b وتميم الدارئي الدارية أن يقوم للناس بأحد عشر ركعة، وكان السلف الصالح يطيلونها جدا. ففي حديث السائب بن يزيد رضي الله عنه قال كان القارئ يقرأ بالمئين يعني بمئات الآيات حتى كنا نعتمد على الأسي من الطول الكيام. وهذا خلاف ما كان عليه كثير من الناس اليوم، حيث يصلون التراويح بسرعة عظيمة لا يأتون فيها بواجب الهدوء والطمأنينة التي هي ركن من أركان الصلاة، لا تصح الصلاة بدونها، فيخلون بهذا الركن ويتعبون من خلفهم من الضعفاء والمرضى وكبار وسن 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 وسن، فيجنون على أنفسهم ويجنون على غيرهم. وقد ذكر العلماء رحمهم الله أنه يكره للإمام أن يسرع سرعة تمنع المأمومين فعل ما يسن، فكيف بسرعة تمنعهم فعل ما يجب، نسأل الله السلامة. So here the Sheikh mentioned previously that is mentioned in the Muwatta of Imam Malik, is a collection of hadith from Imam Malik, that the companion As-Sa'ib, the Ibn Yazid, may Allah be pleased with him, that he said that Umar radiallahu anhu, the Khalifa, he ordered Ubay bin Ka'b, the companion, and Tamim al-Dari, both of them the companions, to establish the prayer, the night prayer, with 11 rakat. So that is with 11 rakat. So that's even proven. And that's a Rawah Malik, fi Muwatta bi isnadihi min asih al-asanid. So the chain is authentic. And then he said that the Salaf, the righteous predecessors, they used to prolong. They used to prolong the prayer, really make it really long. And in mentioning a hadith of Sa'i bin Yazid, may Allah be pleased with him, that he said that the reciter, yeah, the imam, will recite with hundreds of meaning hundreds of ayat. So until we would, you know, basically lean on, depend on sticks, because of the length of time we were standing. And this is is contrary to what the many people are upon today, whereby they pray Taraweeh in so much speed. Subhanallah. This reminds me of something that we were making jokes of in the past, is that Imam Ferrari and stuff, I don't know if you guys, there was one in Indonesia and one in Turkey, where they're reading it so fast. Subhanallah. And the Sheikh says, well, it's so fast that they don't can't come with the wajib of a salah, that a salah is not accepted except with this. And that is, you know, coming with the tranquility and, calmness and tranquility, which is part of the pillar of prayer. So without the prayer, which is the prayer is not accepted. Likewise, now the people make it hard upon the elderly, you know, the sick and the weak who pray behind them. So as a result, they transgress on themselves and others. So the scholars mentioned that it is dislike for the imam to rush his prayer in such a way that it doesn't allow others to implement the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Yeah, so he mentioned that so they do it so what about the one who prays so quickly that he can't, you know, keep up with the wajib from the pillar, which meaning, you know, that having that as we said, from the wajib is that tranquility and that calmness in the prayer. So people can't, if you're doing it so fast, then prayer won't be accepted. And we ask Allah for safety from this. And then the Sheikh said, وَلَا يَنْبَغِي لِلرِّجَالِ أَنْ يَتَخَلَّفَ عَنْ صَلَاةِ التَّرَاوِيِّ لِيَنَالَ ثَوَابُهَا وَأَجْرَهَا وَلَا يَنْصَرِ حَتَّى يَنْتَحِي الْإِمَامُ مِنْهَا وَمِنَ الْوِتْرِ لِيَحْصُلْ لَهُ أَجْرُ قِيَامَ اللَّيْلِ كُلُّهُ وَيَجُوزُ لِلنِّسَاءِ حضور التراوي في المساجد إذا أمن أمن نعم أمنت نعم أمنت الفتنة نعم أمنت من نعم فتنة منهن وبهن لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تمنعوا إماء الله مساجد الله ولأن هذا من أمل السلف الصالح رضي الله عنهم لكن يجب أن تأتي متسترة متحجبة غير متبرجة ولا متطيبة ولا رافعة صوتا ولا مبدية زينة لقول تعالى ولا يبدين زينتهم إلا ما ظهر منها. So here, yeah, the Sheikh goes on to say, it's not befitting for a man to abandon the Taraweeh prayer or to leave the congregation prayer before the Imam finishes. So, you know, no, Imam saying, look, I'm going to leave. No. Rather, he should pray the witr with the Imam in order to him to obtain the reward of the one who prays the whole night. We learn through the hadith that if you stay and pray with the Imam until he finishes, you get the reward of praying the whole night. Yeah. So, and it's also permissible, now the Sheikh mentions, for the women, yeah, to attend the Taraweeh prayer in the masajid as long as they are safe from the temptation and the people are safe from their temptation. This is based on the hadith of Prophet ﷺ, where he said, do not, you know, stop the female slaves of Allah from coming to the masajid. You know, it's mentioned by Bukhari and Muslim. And this was also the way of the Salaf al-Salih, may Allah be pleased with them, that they, but to let the women come to the masajid. But it's obligatory upon the women that they come covered, you know, veiled. They come with hijab, and that they are not coming exposing themselves, you know, in makeup and in showing their faces, and, you know, coming in, you know, displaying their adornments. And they don't come with the perfume as well. And they don't raise their voices. So yeah, so this is based on apparel as well, that clothing that is not come with something that's attracting, and this is based on the Allah, on the ayah that Allah mentions. Let's see, it mentions, and do not display the adornment except that which is apparent. Yeah, so that's Surah Nur, verse 31. And then the Sheikh, he mentions meaning, لكن ما ظهر منها فلا يمكن إخفاؤها وهي الجلباب والإباءة ونحوهما. ولأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما أمر النساء بالخروج إلى الصلاة يوم العيد قالت أم أتية يا رسول الله إحدانا لا يكون لها جلباب، قال لتلبسها أختها من جلبابها. متفق عليه. So here the Sheikh mentions but here what is apparent from it, meaning apparent from her, it means that so this is the that which is apparent is the veil and the jilbab, yeah, is not anything else, yeah, and the abaya, yeah, and whatever's like that. So because the Prophet said when he was commanding the women to come out for the prayer of Eid, yeah, on the day of Eid, Atiyah mentioned, O Messenger of Allah, one of us does not have a garment, so she can't come, jilbab. So the Prophet said, he commanded, let her sister give her a garment to wear. And that's mentioned in Bukhari Muslim. And then the last bit that we mentioned here, وسنة للنساء أن يتأخرن عن الرجال ويبعدن عنهم ويبدأن بالصف المؤخر بالمؤخر عكس الرجال، لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خير الصفوف الرجال أولها وشرها آخرها، وخير الصفوف النساء آخرها وشرها أولها، رواه مسلم. وينصرفنا من المساجد فور تسليم الإمام، ولا يتأخرنا إلا لعذر، لحديث أم سلمة رضي الله عنها قالت كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا سلم قام النساء حين يقضي تسليمه وهو يمكث في مقامه يسيرا قبل أن يقوم. قالت نرى الله أعلم أن ذلك كان لكي ينصرف النساء قبل أن يدركهن الرجال، رواه البخاري. So here the Sheikh mentioned in this paragraph for the women is to delay from the women men to be behind the men and to stay away from them and begin their roles in the masajid making the last roles opposite to the men where the Prophet said the best roles for the men are the first roles and the worst roles are the last roles, and the best roles for the women are the last roles, and the worst roles for the women are the first roles. So here, at that time, when the Prophet was, at the time of the Sahaba, the men and the women, they would pray in one place, and the men would be at the front, and the women would come right at the back. So it's not that we're like today, where we find a lot of the West countries where they're separated. So what would happen is, the best roles obviously are for the first roles for the men, and the best roles for the women are the last roles for the women, so that they won't meet up with the men. And then the Sheikh mentioned that the Prophet that the women he mentioned another hadith by Umm Salama, may Allah be pleased with her, that the Prophet ﷺ, if he would give salam, the women would get up straight away. Yeah, as soon as he gave the salam, the Prophet ﷺ would remain there for a short time. Yeah, so and then he would stand up, and he would say, and she said, now we see that, and Allah knows best, that that was done so that the women could leave before the men could reach them. Yeah, and that was narrated by Bukhari. And then the Sheikh, he mentions as a dua at the end, he says, Allahumma waffaqna lima waffaqta al-qawma waghfir lana wa liwalidina wa li jami' al-muslimina wa bi rahmatika ya arhamur rahimin wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. So the Sheikh, he says, and they make a dua at the end, O Allah, grant us the sweetness, grant us the success of that which you have granted the people of success, and with your mercy, with your mercy, forgive us and our parents and every Muslim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send his peace and blessings upon the Prophet, his family members, and all his companions. So inshallah, with that, bismillah, we finish. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.